I did but see her passing by, and yet I love her till I die.
We love it, don't we? The immortal words of Sir Robert Menzies to the young Queen back in 1963. This is Meet the Press. A love affair with the Queen resumes this week as Her Majesty arrives for her 16th visit to our shores. And one of her most loyal subjects is Professor David Flint, National Convener of Australians for Constitutional Monarchy. Good morning, Professor Flint.
Good morning.
One of the remarkable things, which I wasn't aware of, is that she is the only reigning monarch ever to, this is her 16th visit, but she's actually the only one ever who came here during the time that she was reigning. So the association goes back a long way, and she's the one who's really kept it more real and personal than any other monarch in the system.
Yes, of course, travel is much more easy these days. The previous ones came as heirs, never as king.
True enough.
There was a plan to bring her father here, but he got sick.
Professor Flint, notwithstanding the renewed popularity for the royal family in Australia, how long do you think the current constitutional arrangement can be maintained or sustained? Isn't it inevitable that one day Australia will become a republic, whether it's decades or even 100 years, 200 years? It's an inevitability, isn't it?
Well, we're already a republic. We're a crowned republic. But there's no need to change the crown. The Australian crown works very well. There are other aspects of the constitutional system that don't work very well. Freedom of political speech, for example, the way that power is concentrated in Canberra, the disempowerment of the people between elections. These are much more serious issues. The one that's working is the crown.
But isn't it inevitable, considering generational change? I mean, do you expect that generations to come will still maintain a support for the current arrangement?
Monarchy renews itself, as we've seen with William and Kate, but in addition, I think Australians are very sensible political and constitutional people. They won't change something which works and works very well. While we have a federation, while it's a Westminster federation, we need an institution which is above politics. That is the Australian crown. It's completely Australianised and it works very well.
Can I ask you about the plan that's now been put that females would succeed later males in the royal family as successors to the throne? Do you agree with that plan?
I personally support that. I think the best sovereigns that we've ever had, Elizabeth I, Victoria and Elizabeth II, have all been women. There's no reason why women shouldn't be the first to succeed. And there's an indication of that with the Sovereign Grants Bill, which says that the firstborn person, male or female, will succeed to the duchy that maintains the Prince of Wales. I think it's inevitable.
Where does this idea come from? Because it's sort of being put about that David Cameron, the British Prime Minister, is out there gathering support for it, but presumably he wouldn't be proceeding with it unless it had already been ticked off, essentially, in some conversation with the Queen.
Yes, the constitutional practice requires that anything like this be presented to the Queen for her approval, and that apparently has been done, and that's been made clear. The Queen has no problem with doing away with what's technically called male primogeniture. The other thing is people in the line of succession marrying Catholics, the next step would be to allow Catholics. And there's no reason why we had James II, a Catholic, as king.
Can I take you back to some of your previous jobs to do with the Press Council and media regulation, ask you what you think of the media inquiry, which has now been set up, and where do you think that should go? What big changes would you like to see out of that?
I'm disturbed to see that it actually exists, because it is clearly targeted against one media house, and I think that's dangerous. But also, they're going into areas which have nothing to do with them. Jacobson famously said relations between the press and the government are deteriorating. They're deteriorating further, and on no account must they be allowed to improve. It is essential in a democracy that relations between the media and government be hostile. If you don't have that, then obviously the media are not doing their job.
What are the areas that are particularly worrying you?
Well, firstly, in relation to what happened concerning the alleged defamation of the Prime Minister, I was concerned that that didn't just lead to an action, that it led effectively to three journalists being either disciplined or threatened with discipline. We've got Michael Smith, who was dismissed from Station 2UE, and I assume it was over that. Then, of course, we also have the Racial Discrimination Act. We have this ridiculous provision which the Press Council is opposed to, which allows you to take action if you are, if you subjectively are insulted. Now, I've been called on a Republican site, I've been called a permatanned Indonesian-born blow-in. Now, what should I do about that? I'm not going to be such a wimp, such a person against freedom of speech, that I go off to some bureaucratic body and say, please do something about it.
Well, you don't go to a bureaucratic body, you go to the court.
Oh, well, even then, I wouldn't bother going to court. I think this is dealt with best in the marketplace of ideas. If you go into the kitchen, if you don't like to go going into the kitchen, you don't go there. If you don't like public affairs, get out of it.
So was the Bolt decision, sorry, Michelle, was the Bolt decision an impediment on free speech, in your view?
Without doubt, without doubt. And I'll be surprised if, when it reaches the High Court, they don't say this breaches the implied freedom of political speech which we have found in the Constitution. If they don't say that, the implied freedom is not worth much money.
So that you would say this legislation should be repealed?
Oh, without doubt, without doubt. I can see that we shouldn't be a racist when we speak, but this is an area where you've got to allow debate, you've got to allow robust debate, and if you don't allow that, we don't have freedom of speech.
This whole notion of a media inquiry was born out of some things that happened in the UK that have no relevance to journalism or media in Australia. Would you see it as just a witch hunt by a deeply unpopular government trying to find another excuse for their problems?
That, I think, is the unfortunate side of it. It's most unfortunate, and they shouldn't be doing it.
OK. Professor David Flint, great to have you here, particularly on the week that the Queen is arriving. Thank you very much for joining us. Thanks also to our panel, Michelle Grattan and Simon Benson. A transcript and a replay of the program will be on our website, also on our Facebook page. So until next week, goodbye.